First, a nice introduction. Let me start from maybe introducing myself and telling you a couple of words about my relation to algebra department. So I was, as many people here, I was an undergraduate student and graduate student of the Faculty of Mechanics and Mathematics, and in particular of algebra department. And after I obtained my PhD in 2001, I joined the academic staff of Department of Algebra, and I worked at the Department of Algebra till 2008, so for 7.5 years, till I moved to Slovenia. And nowadays I work in Slovenia in the University of Ljubljana, and also in Institute of Mathematics, Physics and Mechanics of Ljubljana. Well, I thank my colleagues in Kyiv for organizing such nice and interesting conference with really rich program. And it's my great pleasure and honor to be given an opportunity to make a talk here, and also great pleasure to meet everybody, well, at least virtually here, all my colleagues and friends. On the occasion of 60th anniversary, I wish algebra department further flourishing, and to all people who work at algebra department or are related to algebra department, I wish health, well-being, and every success. Let me go on to my talk. Today I'm going to talk about F inverse monoids in enriched signature. This is a joint work with Karl Oinger from University of Vienna and Maria Sandrei from University of Szeged. Just a second. I'm sorry. Okay, so now it works. Let me recall some definitions. So a semigroup S is called regular if for each element A of S there exists element B such that identities ABA equals to A and BAB equals to B hold. So for example, if S is a group and B is inverse element of A, this is the case. So it's kind of generalization of inverse element in a group. Such an element is called an inverse element of A, also in semigroup. And semigroup is called regular if each element of S if it has an inverse, yes? And semigroup is called inverse if each element has a unique inverse, okay? And one can show that a semigroup is inverse if and only if it's regular and its idempotents commute, okay? So we can speak about semilattice of idempotents of inverse semigroup. So some easy examples: semigroup of all self-maps of a set. It's easy to show that it's a regular semigroup, but it's not inverse unless axis of cardinality one. It's easy exercise to show. But if you go to partial maps and to partial injective maps, we get symmetric inverse semigroup of all partial injective maps of a set X. And with respect to composition of partial maps, and this semigroup turns out to be inverse. And Preston-Wagner theorem says that every inverse semigroup is isomorphic to an inverse subsemigroup of some I of X. So we can think about this result as of an analog of Kelly theorem for inverse semigroups. And this representation, this faithful representation, was quite similar as this classical, the left regular representation of a group, which produces the proof of Kelly theorem. There is another approach to inverse semigroup, namely varietal approach. One can show that an algebra with binary multiplication operation and unary inversion operation, so we can think of taking the inverse element as a unary operation on S, right? And we can add this operation to semigroup signature and we get algebra. And one can show that this algebra is an inverse semigroup if and only if the following identities hold, which you see on screen. So first two identities say that taking inverse is an involution. Third one is that definition which we saw on previous slide. and commutation of idempotence is captured by the last identity. Okay. If you add one, we get monoid. We can speak of inverse semigroups or of inverse monoids. I will mostly speak about monoids in my talk, but it doesn't really matter too much. So inverse semigroups and inverse monoids form varieties of algebras, and one can wonder what is the structure of free objects, and let Fix denote the free X-generated inverse monoid. Okay, this time I'm talking about monoids for semigroups, very similar with very, very small changes, which I won't mention even. So structure is well known. There are many various, quite similar to each other, combinatorial approaches to the structure of free inverse monoid. And I will mention, I will need the following description of the free inverse monoid. So let FGX be the free X-generated group, and we consider its Kelly graph. Okay. And now, what do we do? We consider all pairs gamma G, where gamma is a finite connected subgraph of this Kelly graph, which contains the origin and contains vertex G. Okay, and we define the following multiplication. So gamma G delta H equals gamma union G delta comma GH. So group elements are just multiplied, and you take union of gamma with kind of translation of delta, so left translation of delta under the action. It's not proper action, it's partial action in fact, but it doesn't matter at this moment. So it's kind of semi-direct like product construction. Well, one can check that it's well defined, so inversion operation is also well defined, and the identity element is just one, so one is subgraph that consists of one only, of the origin only, and one is group element. Well, quite nice combinatorial description. So this is the model for free inverse monoid, X-generated inverse monoid. Let us see which properties does this free inverse monoid have. But before formulating properties, I need to recall some definitions. So if S is an inverse semigroup by ES, we usually denote this semilattice of idempotence. So on idempotence, you have natural partial order where A is below B, if and only if product A, B equals B equals to A, and you can think of product as the greatest lower bound of A and B, that's why semilattice. Natural partial order is defined like this, and actually A is below B, if and only if, thinking about faithful representation in symmetric inverse semigroup when A is partial bijection, which is restriction of partial bijection B, so it's natural partial order. Well, one can wonder what is the maximum group quotient of an inverse semigroup, and we come to a notion of minimum group congruence. So two elements are it's denoted by sigma, and two elements are in relation sigma if and only if some of the restrictions are equal to another, or there is element which simultaneously below the two elements A and B. So what is the first observation? This congruent sigma must identify all idempotents, because every idempotent should be mapped to the identity element of maximum group quotient, right? So all idempotents are in one sigma class, but there are two possibilities. It may happen that there are some other elements beyond idempotents in the sigma class, but it may happen there are only idempotents. So in the case, when sigma is idempotent pure, so any element which is in sigma relation with idempotent is idempotent itself, such semigroup is called E-unitary. In the case when each sigma class contains a maximum element with respect to partial order, S is called F-inverse. Okay, so these are our two central definitions. So one can show that each F-inverse monoid is E-unitary, but the converse is not true. We will see examples shortly. It's easy to see that each F-inverse semigroup is necessarily a monoid. So because this sigma class of all idempotents contains maximum idempotent, and it's easy to show that this maximum idempotent is in fact the identity element. And now we can go on to properties of the free inverse monoid. So element pair gamma g is idempotent if and only if g equals to 1. A natural partial order if and only if g equals to h, and gamma is over graph of delta. Okay, so direction is reversed here. So biggest element has smallest graph, underlying graph. Sigma relation also very transparent. So two elements are in sigma if and only if their second components are equal. And maximum group image is free group fgx, and canonical projection just sends pair gamma g to g. Okay, I hope it's quite simple, clear, and you follow. From this description, this can be directly verified, easy exercise. And from this description, it follows that sigma is idempotent pure, because sigma class, which is mapped to 1, consists only of elements gamma 1. Okay, and it proves that the semigroup Fix is e-unitary. It's e-unitary. We could wonder if it is F inverse, and the answer is yes, it is, because each sigma class has a maximum element. So sigma classes are determined by second component. So sigma class consists of all pairs gamma G, where G is fixed. And we said the smaller element is, bigger graph is. So maximum element corresponds to smallest subgraph. And there is smallest connected subgraph, which is a path from origin to G. Kelly graph of free group is a tree, so there is such a path. It's smallest possible connected subgraph that contains 1 and g as vertices, and this element, such an element gamma g is maximum element of its sigma class. So we have made sure that fix is f inverse. Okay, so now maybe a couple of motivating words about why it's interesting to study e-unitary and f-inverse monoids, semigroups, e-unitary semigroups and f-inverse monoids. Well, these have many applications in other branches of mathematics, for example, in the theory of partial actions, which were in Misha's talk yesterday, I think. Moreover, they have applications in the theory of sister algebras, notably in the theory of sister algebras constructed out of combinatorial objects, very, very vivid area nowadays. And maybe formulate an open question, long-standing open question. So if F-inverse monoid T is a cover of inverse monoid S, if S is a quotient of T under an idempotent separating congruence, okay? Notion of a cover. Now one can show that it's quite easy. Every inverse monoid M has an F inverse cover. That's not difficult to see. So every monoid M is a quotient of some free inverse monoid. So M is quotient of some free inverse monoid under some congruence denoted by theta. Well, it may not be idempotent separating, but if we quotient F by theta intersection with sigma, that does the job. Some verifications have to be made, but this monoid is an F inverse cover of M. It can be quite easily shown. Basically, it's the only known universal construction of F inverse cover of a monoid M, okay, as far as I know. And for finite monoid M, it may happen that this one is infinite, of course. And open problem which was first explicitly formulated by Henken and Rhodes in 1991, does every finite inverse monoid have a finite F-inverse cover? Okay, it's an open problem. In this paper, Henken and Rhodes, they showed that if this were true, then so-called point-like conjecture would have a positive answer. Then Ash provided positive solution to point-like conjecture in the same year, 1991, he published that. But finite F-inverse cover conjecture problem. Well, I don't know if it's conjecture, because I'm not sure what is the conjecture, yes or not. So it's problem. It's still open. Now I'm going on, and I want I'd like to present two examples of. One example of e-unitary inverse semigroup, it will be monoid, which is obtained from combinatorial geometrical actually, and then an example of an F-inverse monoid. Okay, then after that, I will link these two examples together and upgrade both examples. So Margolis make an expansion of an X-generated group. So the construction of free inverse monoid, which we have just seen, is a particular instance of this Margolis make an expansion of a group. So now G is not necessarily a free group over X, but it's any X-generated group, and we consider respective Kelly graph of the group presentation. Okay, and how do we define Margolis Meekin expansion? So we have this Kelly graph, and we play the same game as before. So we consider all pairs gamma G, where gamma is finite connected subgraph containing one and G as vertices. G is element of G. Okay, and multiplication and taking inverse and fixing identity element are just the same as before. I just put as one and two, and these are those formulas on one of previous slides, just similar as in free inverse monoid. So this construction is pretty similar to free inverse monoid. Just we took arbitrary group presentation, a generated group. Well, what can be shown? So we denote this inverse monoid by M of G. We can show that it is X generated, just the same as group G. And generator X is represented by the following pair. It is gamma X, XG. XG is just evaluation of X and G. You can just think of just of X if you don't get confused by evaluations of letters in various objects. And here just origin and just one arrow along generator X to X, to evaluation of X in G. Okay, and these guys generate M of G. Well, idempotents have just the same similar structure as before. So gamma one, where gamma is a vertex, where one is a vertex of gamma. And it follows, by the way, that similarities of idempotents is isomorphic to similarities of finite subgraphs of KG, which contain the origin, and meet operation is just union of subgraphs. Stuart Margolis and John Meekin in 1989 proved the universal property of this object of M of G. Before I formulate it, I just mentioned that its quotient over sigma is isomorphic to G, and the canonical projection to G goes as follows. So gamma G is mapped to G, very, very transparent and easy construction. And moreover, well, here comes to one difference, actually. M of G is not in general F inverse. It is an F inverse if and only if Kelly graph is a tree. Why? Because if it's not a tree, you're not able to choose a connected maximal, smallest connected subgraph that joins origin with given vertex. Yes, it can be just one way and second way. And if you take their intersection, you lose connectedness. Okay, so you cannot choose smallest connected subgraph. So it's not in general F inverse. Being E unitary, it's not F inverse in general. Well, and it turns out that M of G is the freest possible X-generated E-unitary inverse monoid with maximum group quotient G. So here I drew this canonical projection from M of G to G, and it turns out that this canonical projection factors through any E-unit X-generated E-unitary inverse monoid with maximum group quotient G. So this one, M of G, is really the freest one. Okay, so second example which I wanted to talk about is Sandre's model of the Bergerot's prefix group expansion. So here we are lucky. I will tell you the construction faster because it's in a way similar to previous construction. So here difference is that we do not consider Kelly graphs. We consider just group G. And out of group G, we want to construct an interesting inverse semigroup. How does the construction go? We consider all pairs AG, where A is a finite subset of G containing 1 and G. Okay? And multiplication and taking inverse are given like here, and you see similarity with this previous object. Okay? semi-direct like product construction, but it's not true semi-direct product, just because there are restrictions on the first component and doesn't go about action, but only about partial action. Anyway, adimportance are described as pairs A1. Similarities of adimportance is similarities of finite subsets of G containing 1 with respect to union of subsets. Something very natural you can construct out of a group. So if you anybody asks you, given a group, you want to construct some semi-lattice out of this group, so internally. So we have group, what can we do with it? We can take finite subsets containing 1, and we can take their unions. It's something very simple, almost the first thing which comes to your mind. So here we can show that this Sandry expansion is an F inverse monoid. Why? Because sigma class which is mapped to G contains maximum element. You can take subset just consisting of 1 and G. Okay, it has two elements, 1 and G. And this element is maximum element. It's true because it's clear, yes, because you cannot throw away 1 and you cannot throw away G. It's requirement that 1 and G are contained in the subset, and it's one of the minimal possible subset. So it's F inverse. And moreover, it's G generated. So elements 1, comma G generate this monoid. So it's G generated. And it turns out, but the map from G, so when G is mapped to respective generator, it's not homomorphisms, it's only premorphism. So it corresponds to partial action of group G on the similarities of adimportance, which I've just described. And quite similar to a previous result by Margolis and Mikin, there is a result by Maria Sandry, obtained in 1989, that this Sandry expansion is the freest possible F-inverse monoid with maximum group quotient G. So if you have any other one having these properties, then this canonical projection factors through this S. Okay. Okay, so now I'm coming to the title of my talk. So F inverse monoids in enriched signature. So what is the idea? So suppose we are given an F inverse monoid, and by A to M we denote the maximum element of sigma class of A. Okay, such element exists and is unique, and this defines unary operation on X on S. So what we can do? We can add this unary operation to the signature of S. So consider is S algebra with binary multiplication, unary inversion, unary M operation, and 1, it's just fixing the identity element. And from now on, saying F inverse monoid, I will mean F inverse monoid in this enriched signature. Well, what is true? It's observation made by Michael Kinyon in 2014. That an algebra S with this operations is an F inverse monoid if and only if without M it is inverse monoid, and these two conditions hold. So one can check that these two hold in any F inverse monoids, and moreover it's if and only if. It easily follows now that F inverse monoids form a variety of algebras. Well, it's not written so that you see directly that it's a variety. Here it's greater or equal, but you can easily modify it into an identity. And this one, for any idempotent, you can replace A times A minus 1 and make this identity. So it's F inverse monoids really form a variety of algebras. So it looks very natural definition. And first question, which one may ask, what is the structure of free F inverse monoid? Is there a geometric model based on Cayley graph of free group? Something maybe similar to geometric model of a free inverse monoid. And now I will present an answer to these questions. I will do a slightly more general construction. So I will start from an X-generated group, and free F inverse monoid will be obtained when this group is just free X-generated group. So now I take any X-generated group and consider Cayley graph of group presentation. So have some group, I generated, have some presentation, and this data defines Cayley graph. Well, by F of G, we denote the set of all pairs, gamma G, where G is element of group, and gamma is a finite subgraph of Cayley KG containing 1 and G as vertices. her, I removed connected. It's intentionally. So operations are given again similarly as for Margulis Meekin expansion, which we saw already. So f of g is almost the same as m of g. We only drop connected. Okay. So why should our subgraphs be connected? Not necessarily connected, but finite, containing one and gs vertices. Well, so properties quite similar as previously. One difference that now it is F inverse because a maximum element of sigma class is subgraph which has no edges but, and contains two vertices, one and g. It should be, it's similar to maximum element of sigma classes for Sendri expansion, by the way. So some mixture, you see a mixture of Sendri expansion and Margulis-Meekin expansion. Well, one can show, check, so it's straightforward to check that this object is an F-inverse monoid when where gamma G to M is this delta G, G. So we just replace a gamma by the smallest possible graph. It's not connected unless G equals to one, having one and G as vertices. Okay, one can show that F of G is X generated as F-inverse monoid in enriched signature and by the same generators as for M of G. Quotient over sigma is isomorphic to G. Well, so F of G naturally contains both M of G and Sendri expansion of G. So M of G, you just take inverse submonoid without prohibiting taking M operation on the same generator. So this way you produced all pairs with gamma being connected. Well, now elements which have no edges at all constitute an inverse submonoid, which is isomorphic to Sendri expansion. So if there are no edges, there are only some vertices, and set of vertices is a finite subset containing one and G. So you can look at it as element of Sendri expansion we've introduced several minutes ago. Okay, so some mixture of these two objects. Well, I think quite nice combinatorial object in my view. And it will be no surprise if I say that it has universal property, just similar as before. So it's our result with Carl and Maria, that this F of G is freest possible F inverse monoid, X generated F inverse monoid with maximum group quotient G, okay? So similar picture, I just copy-pasted pictures four times actually, but it goes about different objects. Yes, so if F is any other F inverse monoid with maximum group quotient G, which is X generated, that is canonical projections factors for F. And in particular, this gives us a geometric model of the free F inverse monoid. So it is F of free group. So Kelly graph of free group and not necessarily finite, not necessarily connected subgraphs containing one and G and S vertices. Well, here I included several slides about this idea of proof, but I should be very short. I think that my time is coming to the end. So if you're familiar with the proof of the structure of free inverse monoid, you consider spanning paths in Kelly graph of free group, say, of any generated group. So here, instead of some people call them spanning walks, okay? So walk which spans the whole graph and starts at the origin and comes to the vertex G. Here, instead of spanning paths, I skip this slide, we introduce spanning journeys. So we go by edges of graph, but sometimes we need to come to another connected component. So we jump from one component to another component. So we have walking along graph and also jumping to other connected components. Now how is it realized algebraically? So if you go along edges, you just write down generators, okay? X union X minus one stars of this free monoid. But when you need to jump, what you do? You take all possible group elements between these two. So you have G, H, you take G minus one to H. You take all possible group elements and you take that in your evaluation in F inverse monoid. Anyway, all these guys who have this group component, this one, they will have the same evaluation. So you take any term to M. Knowing that, so there are many labels for this jump, but they all will have the same evaluation. Okay, so I skip the slide. And actually, if I have 1 or 2 minutes, just a couple of words about another object, perfect F inverse monad, and universal perfect F inverse monad. So F inverse monad is called perfect if sigma is a perfect congruence, which means that product of two classes, sigma classes, is again a sigma class. And it means that we have this additional identity for the variety of perfect F inverse monads. And again, the same question, can we repeat our game for perfect F inverse monad? And construction is again very, very transparent. We can describe it combinatorially. So answer is the following. We consider the same set of pairs, but now gamma is a finite subgraph with no isolated vertices. Okay, so no isolated vertices. And what is the projection of FG to PG, to this, the perfect guy? So we take this pair, gamma G, and what we do? We pass to the pair gamma prime G, where gamma prime is obtained from gamma by erasing all isolated vertices. You just erase all isolated vertices and you get projection from FG to PG. It turns out, so now it's not true, so by the way, identity element here is different, empty set one. It's no longer true that gamma should contain one and G as vertices. It's not required because we erase all isolated vertices. And it turns out that this is just semi-direct product of similarities of suitable subgraphs acted upon by group G. So it's just semi-direct product. And it's kind of mysterious, it was mysterious for us that this object does not depend on the geometry of Cayley graph, unlike M of G and F of G. But we found explanation for that. So that's how it happens. Yes, and again, universal property, quite similar to universal property we've seen before for previous objects. If you want to study more details, it can be done from preprint of our paper. So this paper was accepted for publication to Indiana University Mathematics Journal, and on the website of journal there is preprint and here I put link to it, or alternatively there is an archive preprint. Thank you very much for your attention.